This is an essay about four movies that have almost nothing in common. Believe it or not, it started as an essay about the Oscars. Missed that deadline, huh? About 12 months ago, I conceptualized a year of these essays, something that could be framed as a season. I didn't know what they'd all be on, though I had a text document full of ideas, and I didn't get through as many as I hoped. It turns out, video editing gets more time-consuming, not less, as you get better at it. Incredibly frustrating. And at the time, I thought I'd wrap that season up with a video about the Oscars, and through the Oscars, some movies I loved over the course of the year. But you already know what's good about the Oscars.
I wrote something down because if I thought if it would happen, I'd be a little overwhelmed, and I am.
These are the most charismatic people in the world. People who are professionally the most charismatic people in the world, who live their lives in pursuit of making entertainment and culture for the mass public. Ever since I saw Babylon, I've been thinking about a couple of scenes in it that show how these people who are trying, who are experts, still don't really know until the moment they put the thing they've been making in front of the audience, the thing they struggle to make, with all their sincerity, and maybe the audience just laughs at them. I think about that a lot. There are a lot of things, quote, wrong with the Oscars, but the one that sticks, the one you can tell really gets to them, is the accusation that they've lost touch with the ordinary person. For my own part, this accusation seems hilarious. For two reasons. One, Hollywood is the most populist faction of the most populist art form possibly in the history of humankind. And so if you're arguing that Hollywood has lost touch with the ordinary person, you end up just making a populist argument against art entirely. Two, Hollywood, in their anxiety over this accusation, takes this beautiful thing, this thing that can be sincere, glamorous, and powerful all at once.
Ooh, it's genuinely quite stressful.
And keeps humiliating themselves trying to turn it into the most lightweight, least funny comedy roast.
Then I am happy to see that Nicole Kidman has finally been released from that abandoned AMC.
What I've come to crystallize over this past year or so is that competent execution enables, which is to say it's necessary for, but does not constitute, the thing that is really there underneath art, the possibility of engagement. That to give a movie Best Picture is a phenomenal opportunity to recognize people who deserve recognition, and through that, to celebrate the devotion, effort, and care of an entire community.
Especially this year, when the world finally got out of the house to see the films you worked so hard to make.
But it does not speak, any more than it speaks to say that The Marriage of Figaro,
the Cartoon Network, home of the top two stars,
is the best opera of 1786, or The Night Watch is the best painting of 1648. It's probably true, but it doesn't represent engaging. It does not tell you how you will feel when you stand in its presence and watch the light play off the brushstrokes. So I want to talk about four movies from 2022 that didn't win Oscars. None of them were my favorite movie of the year, and I'm not even going to try to persuade you that they are good. Some were good, some were better than others. I want to talk about them because I thought their ambitions, their efforts to reach us, were under-recognized. I want to talk about them because the rough edges are so often the places where the artist was having thoughts I hadn't already had. I want to talk about them really for no other reason than that I found them engaging. In 1949, Ingrid Bergman was a superstar. She had been brushed off as an elder industry-manufactured starlet, but she confounded the business by consistently backing up her unquestionable beauty and screen presence with an incredible level of skill and commitment. In just a few years, she'd been through some of Hollywood's most recognizable classics, movies like Notorious, The Bells of St. Mary's, Spellbound, Gaslight, and Casablanca. Bergman was also trapped by social norms and financial legalities in an unhappy marriage with a controlling husband, which she dealt with by having affairs with co-stars, directors, and celebrity acquaintances, men like Cary Grant and Howard Hughes. These affairs were an open secret, but the movie press, as was normal at the time, kept that secret from the public to protect the images of the men involved. Then she went to Italy to do a Rossellini film called Stromboli, Land of God, and Bergman did exactly what she'd done many times before. But Rossellini wasn't with the studios, he wasn't an American celebrity, and he didn't have to be protected. In Italy, the news of their affair was received with apathy, but in America, it was a national scandal. The press that had seemed understanding for so long suddenly sensationalized her and destroyed her reputation. Audiences turned their backs on her. She was denounced, this isn't a joke, on the floor of the US Senate. Here's the twist. The movie she made with Rossellini, by all accounts, that movie is either completely fine or quite good. And in Europe, where there had been no scandal, it was received warmly. But in America, the critics, the press, the audience, and even the movie's distributor had worked themselves into such a frenzy of cathartically hating Bergman that they attacked the movie as unsalvageably terrible because they weren't evaluating the movie. They were evaluating the opportunity to participate in a collective sport of disapproving of Ingrid Bergman and the weirdo Italian director who'd seduced her, or been seduced by her? Whichever was convenient. Anyway, Don't Worry Darling is completely fine. Interesting, even. If everything you know about Don't Worry Darling is contextualized by the press tour, by memes about Chris Pine, by articles about LaBeouf and Stiles and Pugh and Wilde and Sudeikis, put it all down. None of that has anything to do with the movie. Here's what Don't Worry Darling is. It's a paranoid thriller that uses a sort of Stepford Wives construct to target what's sometimes called the manosphere. The ways in which regressive assertions of traditional masculinity trap men in destructive hollow patterns, following destructive hollow people, and inflicting that hollow destructiveness on the people, on the women around them. It's got some problems, mostly in its pacing. It holds all its reveals until too late, making it seem to drag and then to suddenly barrage you with a mess of revelations. But Wilde's direction is striking and leaves space for the compelling work of her colleagues. Chris Pine gives an incredible performance as a villain inspired by Jordan Peterson, exposing his character's total lack of not just a soul, but even of any elementary insight or compassion, creating a character who is coherently all four of well-spoken, authoritative, sociopathic, and totally vacuous.
Whose world is it?
Harry Styles, though clearly not an experienced actor, does a solid job as a man desperately, obsessively performing the mechanics of a self-imposed masculine role because his feelings of inadequacy, feelings that same role cannot allow him to express, eat him alive from the inside. And Don't Worry Darling could easily have been considered for, honestly could have won, awards for lead actress, best production design, best score, and... sound. But you already know, without me telling you, the reason it wasn't considered for those awards, why those things about it weren't that much discussed at all, and that reason has nothing to do with what's in the movie. So imperfect as it was, I was still thinking about Don't Worry Darling after I left the theater. Even now, I still think about it sometimes. At this point, it's just frustrating to try to bring a critical eye to superhero movies. In 2022, if they hadn't already, Marvel movies finally blossomed into what's surely their final form, the hype Ouroboros. The machine's outputs aren't bad, they're mostly on their own terms between decent and good, but each individual one is basically impervious to critical discussion, because every critical discussion of each one of them is about the same stuff, and even more importantly, only done only possible in reference to other Marvel movies. You cannot discuss the movies in isolation, you can only discuss the machine, and since that's all you can do, that's what everyone does, and that conversation gets old fast, too. And the movies are mostly fine, so fair enough. Their competitors, over at Warner Brothers, spent the last several years in a moderately successful experiment just hiring interesting filmmakers to make movies, an experiment that I, for the most part, appreciated. But in 2022, Warners finally bowed to investors and to their own bad PR and abandoned the experiment. Instead, trying once again to recapture the massive financial success of the MCU, failing to notice perhaps that the MCU is no longer quite the financial behemoth it once was, or that not one effort by any competitor has successfully imitated it. This time, we are assured, will not be like the last time. This time, they're putting a probable total investment of a few billion dollars just in the first few years behind half a decade of related projects, developed by a moderately controversial, moderately famous nerd auteur, with some successful projects and some embarrassing failures, who's well-liked among colleagues but has no relevant experience independently producing even one mega-budget film, let alone simultaneously independently coordinating several of them at once. And fair enough, I'm surprised they didn't do it sooner.
The whole back.
It's like a reflex with me, Armo.
But sliding in right under the wire was Black Adam. True to form, a messy, interesting, thematically rich movie, almost certainly the most thematically detailed, thematically complex movie in its genre in several years. Sometimes I find myself wondering if Dwayne Johnson knows what Black Adam is about. Like, does he know, but he knows it doesn't sell, so he promoted it as something else to sell tickets? Or did he never get it at all? The problem is, something went wrong with Black Adam. Though one can't really know, it looks and feels like a movie badly damaged in the editing booth, possibly for runtime. It's not as funny as it's supposed to be, which is to say, the script is funny, and the actors delivering the lines are funny people, but few of the jokes land because the pacing is all wrong. The basic story structure is a mess. For example, at one point, Black Adam gives up his powers and asks the Justice Society to immobilize him so he can never get them back. And they do. And then the literal next time we see him, 5 minutes later, he gets them back. It gives the impression of a movie that was supposed to be paced very differently from what we saw. I don't know whose fault that is, or if it's anyone's fault, but it gives Black Adam a strange velocity that's hard to engage with. But under that is a surprisingly sophisticated examination of modern superhero stories. Who and what they're for, who and what they can be. Basically, by setting the Justice Society and Black Adam against each other as they both try to resolve the same problem with different goals and different methods, the movie is able to use them to ask about the different kinds of superhero stories they represent. The Justice Society is a depiction of Silver Age heroes, charming, self-assured, unthreatening, static, and Western, a depiction that we see on screen today in most Marvel movies. Black Adam is a depiction of more modern, violent, outsider heroes who don't respect established power, who wear their psychological damage on their sleeves, and who express it with violence, a depiction that's been brought to the screen in a few different ways, but most famously in Zack Snyder's Superman trilogy.
The only way to know how strong is to keep testing your limits.
While the movie shows affection for both, it lands as a pretty strong defense of the grittier, more modern depiction. I don't entirely agree with its argument, but we'll come back to that. Black Adam is shown as having some things to learn. He has to be less violent, be more social, be less self-obsessed, but it's plausible that he will learn them. Indeed, this is a character arc that he undergoes in the movie. By contrast, while the members of the movie's Justice Society are likable and heroic, the organization is essentially a stagnant organization that functions as a tool of Western post-imperial power, going to places where their presence isn't helpful, doing things that are heroic but unproductive, and then leaving. Through that lens, the Justice Society in Kandak becomes a kind of commentary on the way that superhero stories fit into a Western superpower culture, like how Chris Nolan ends up using Batman as a kind of Jack Bauer, or how Marvel's Avengers, four Americans, an alien coded as Scandinavian, and a Russian who defected to the Americans without missing a beat, are leveraged as a kind of superhero SEAL Team 6. Just identify the target, send them in, and keep the world safe for democracy. Which is to say, while the film thinks Black Adam needs to grow up, the Justice Society needs something more revolutionary. And no, I don't know that I entirely agree with this argument. Parts of the critique are spot on. It's striking that several MCU movies have attempted to address these criticisms from within, and only once come even close to succeeding, itself then being largely dropped from the story afterwards. On the other hand, while one can imagine that these more modern, grittier, outsidery, Snydery, if you will, depictions have the potential to depict something more thematically useful, you'll scroll through the DC films in vain, whatever their other merits might have been, for anything that actually did what Black Adam wants them to do. You'd have to go back to something like Del Toro's Hellboy movies for anything close, I think.
All us freaks have is each other.
But these thematic ideas, a good argument or not, are not concealed in the movie. You'll find them, and other ideas I haven't even gotten to, the minute you approach Black Adam looking for any thematic reading. And so, for all of that, the most interesting thing about Black Adam might not be what those themes are, but that no one told you about them. That no one told you that Black Adam is a deeply flawed film, even to the extent that it might be unenjoyable, but also one with startlingly high creative ambitions. And they didn't tell you that in part because some of them were paying too much attention to the opportunity to dunk on silly promotional stuff about the balance of power in a DC universe to watch the movie for what it was. In 2022, all of the attention to great animated movies went to Guillermo del Toro's Pinocchio. A little bit Puss in Boots with its Spider-Verse-inspired visuals, but mostly Pinocchio. Fair enough, Pinocchio's a remarkable movie. The little touches of Frankenstein, or the way the stop-motion animation brings the whole movie to bear on the thematic statement, great. My own favorite animated movie of 2022 was The Sea Beast. Coincidentally, it was also 2022's best CGI-driven ocean movie about imperialism, cultural and social exclusion, the struggle to be yourself and fit into your family at the same time.
What, are you picturing us on a farm or something?
I said never mind, you donkey.
And the evils of whaling. Okay, compared to the animation you'll see in Marcel the Shell with Shoes On, Pinocchio, or Puss in Boots The Last Wish, the Sea Beast visuals probably won't floor you. And yet, within the realm of things I knew animation could do, the Sea Beast was frequently impressive, frequently beautiful, always effective, and never boring. It was a competence and effectiveness that left me revisiting how I think about what style and invention are really doing for animated movies. The Sea Beast is the story of three generations of hunters. An older, seasoned hunter played by Jared Harris.
Are you kidding me?
No, you're a grimy little pimp.
Excellent as ever, desperate to save his noble profession from oncoming modernization. The younger prodigy, played by Carl Urban.
Thanks for the heads up.
Also excellent as ever, set to inherit everything, charged with upholding his family's legacy. And the kid, played by Zaris Angel Hathor.
Hi, I'm Zaris Angel Hathor, and I voice Maisie in the upcoming Netflix film, The Sea Beast.
Who somehow upstages both those excellent co-stars, who grew up idolizing them and wanting to imitate them. These three characters are confronted by the realization that, well, whaling and imperialism are bad, actually. It's a kid's movie unapologetically, and it wears its themes on its sleeve. But if the themes are blatant and simplistic, they are also true, important, executed beautifully, and presented without resort to post-ironic jokes or brand-necessitated apologies intended to take all the sting out of a movie that someone might accuse of being so self-serious that it presumes to impose any kind of point on its audience.
Crikey, a Facebook fan page?
I don't just give those away.
Beep, 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 beep.
I don't want to die like this! It's derivative!
It says something good to say, it says it very well, and it isn't sorry that it's doing that for children. And God, if that's not a breath of fresh air. It was a busy year for well-established filmmakers delivering introspective reflections on their relationship with storytelling, movies, or the movie business. We got Babylon, Bardo, Elvis, Empire of Light, The Fablemans, Nope, and 3,000 Years of Longing. I mean, just offhand, probably a couple others too. Of those, a few I don't think are terribly interesting. One is interesting, but I don't really have an original contribution to make about it. One is really interesting, but so filthy that I don't think I can provide several minutes of explanatory clips to help you understand my argument, not within YouTube's content guidelines. One is my favorite movie of last year and moved me so powerfully that I struggle even to talk about it. So instead, let's talk about Elvis. Baz Luhrmann's Elvis? I was skeptical too. His Great Gatsby left me with this feeling that he'd missed something fundamental about the source material. I'm not the person who gets really precious about this, and I was surprised to be left with this feeling that he'd missed something specifically American about Gatsby, and ended up with a surface-level interpretation, missing the roaring 20s cultural critique of the way America imported a generational class structure while building a national ideology out of claiming it didn't have one, creating a social addiction to making money to buy your way into a society that will never take you, and that if you took a moment to look past your blinders, you'd see you shouldn't want to be in.
Here's just the front, but Wolfshine, gangster, to get his claws into respectable folk like Walter Chase.
And landing instead on something blandly universal about ambition, papered onto a roaring 20s costume drama. That made me nervous because Elvis Presley is a very American celebrity. He might be the most American celebrity. The poor southern white boy raised in black neighborhoods listening to Memphis blues, the celebrity who got drafted, who dated his commanding officer's 14-year-old daughter, the hick superstar who got scammed by his manager, the self-taught guitar player who became one of the greatest live performers in history, the musician who tried to break into Hollywood and got churned up by the machine, and probably most importantly, the aging, strung-out Vegas institution, his body destroyed by years of despair and too much southern cooking and addiction to prescription medication, even, as he is addicted himself, crusading against marijuana and collecting honorary appointments to sheriff's departments. Paranoid, unable to perform and unable to not perform, his music having transitioned from revolutionary rock and roll to the most mainstream country, dead at 42, having destroyed his body so thoroughly that doctors don't know which bad habits are the ones that killed him in the end. It's about as American a story as you can tell. After Gatsby, I thought, can Luhrmann really tell this story? Is he going to miss the texture of it again? And the answer is, he didn't do anything I was thinking about. Although Elvis is, in some structural respects, a music biopic, I think much of its reception did it a disservice by stopping there, by treating the film as being in service of the biography. And that's not at all what Elvis is. Elvis is a deeply introspective reflection on the relationship between fame and creative voice. The voice calls out to be heard, calls out for recognition, and if you're good enough and lucky enough, fame shows up and makes you a deal you might come to regret. There's a reason Colonel Tom Parker, already a cartoonish figure in reality, is elevated to monstrous proportions. It's the same reason Elvis's charismatic dancing gyrations are depicted as basically a superpower of remote fucking. It's the same reason the story fixates on the glitzy, cash-soaked unreality of Las Vegas. Choices like these transform Elvis from biopic to what it really is, a fable about having a voice that wants to be heard. It's not uniquely American. It is kind of blankly universal. Is it kind of a trite theme? Maybe yes, but it's inflected with the reality and the authenticity of how clearly Luhrmann, who has been there, who has struggled to maintain his own voice in the face of Hollywood, believes it. For me, Elvis is Luhrmann's magnum opus, the film where all of his maximalist stylistic instincts, his garish colors, his frenetic pace, his melodramatic shot choices, his willingness to play with campy, low-quality CGI compositions and strange focal lengths, where it all comes together in a statement that makes it very clear. He's not missing something everyone else has. There is something in his voice that no one else can do. At the very end of the film, Luhrmann's vision of Elvis, the generous man and uniquely eloquent voice brought low by the power of fame, and my vision of Elvis, the iconic veneration, the idolatry of the greatest excesses of Americana, come together. Reaching the end of his life, Elvis is still performing. He sits at a piano when he performs now because he can't stand through a show anymore, let alone dance. Wasted, ill, with someone holding the microphone for him, his decline is there for everyone to see. He seems sad. He seems pathetic. You can feel everything that he once was. He is out there on stage trying to perform for you, and you just want to give him his privacy. and then he sings.
Time goes by.
And his soul is still there. About 12 months ago, I conceptualized a year of these essays, something that could be structured as a season. I didn't know what they'd all be on. I thought there'd be 10 to 12 of them. I got through 9. I talked about Cats. I talked about Watchmen, my best video, I think. I talked about Star Wars a bit more than I hoped. Probably will again at some point. The last video was about Star Wars, and it quote-unquote did well. That's what you say when a video gets more views than you're used to on YouTube. It did well. I guess I'm happy about that, but dealing with that very limited success taught me something about what the possibilities really are here, what a larger audience would feel like to have. If this one took a while, it's because, to be frank, I found that a bit demoralizing. But it's a reminder that that phrase, doing well, is not my barometer. I wanted to push myself to be better able to think about art, and invite you to, hearing me do that, try to do that for yourself as well. Over those 12 months, what I've come to believe is irreconcilably true is this. Whatever else art can be, it has the capacity to move you, to engage you if you're willing, even occasionally to reach out and shake a part of your soul that you've never found any other way to access. And making a thing, even a thing like this, can be an enterprise in making something that is deeply imperfect, in the hope that the unique grooves of your imperfection will engage someone else. Don't stop watching the things that comfort you. Your comfort is valuable, but I wanted this video to ask you to also go just one step further. To confine your experience of art to the things that you can already fit into a slot is to tyrannize a piece of yourself, to limit your capacity to be moved. If you're here to listen to someone talk about movies, in that form, the most accessible, most mass-market media form imaginable, go just one step further. Watch the movie that got mixed reviews, too. Watch the movie that seems like it was for someone else, too. Watch the movie that's from the wrong franchise. Occasionally they're awful. Occasionally they're unreachable. Sometimes they're just fine. Sometimes they're earnest fun. And sometimes, more than often enough that it's worth the effort, there's something much, much more. If you want to leave plaudits, or, you know, completely earnest, friendly, polite efforts to discuss these movies, hey, leave a comment. And you know, I've got a bunch of videos already planned for the next year of these, on The Crown, celebrity culture and victimization, on Fast and Furious and movie marketing kayfabe, on Twilight fanfiction and female and queer creative spaces, on James Bond's postmodern era. You know, that kind of thing. And if you want to make sure you see those videos and help them to reach more people, it really does help if you like and subscribe. Thanks.